Good afternoon. Welcome to the Center for Disaster Philanthropy webinar, Hurricane Ida, Funding Urgent Needs and Long-Term Recovery. I'm Patty McElreevy, President and CEO of CDP. My pronouns are she, her, hers. This webinar is co-sponsored by Charity Navigator, the Council on Foundations, the Funders Network, Giving Compass, the National Center on Family Philanthropy, National Voluntary Organizations Active in Disasters, Philanthropy New York, the Southeastern Council on Foundations, and the United Philanthropy Forum. Some reminders before we get started. We are recording this webinar. It will be available on our website and YouTube channel shortly after the webinar is complete. While you can access Zoom created captions today, we will have more accurate captions in the recording. You can submit questions at any time using the Q&A box, and we will answer them at the end of the panel presentation. If you are on Twitter, please use hashtag CDP4Recovery to share and join the discussion. At the end of the webinar, there will be a short survey. Please complete this to help us improve our webinar offerings to better meet your needs. Because of the recency of this disaster and current connectivity capacity, our speakers will not be on camera and our slides are going to be a lighter touch than they normally are. Please bear with us and be patient as we listen to insights from our speakers on the ground. In the spirit of healing, I acknowledge and honor the original people of the land where I'm located and where CDP is headquartered, now referred to as Washington, D.C. For many generations, Washington, D.C. has been a meeting and exchange site that Indigenous communities have lived on and been connected to. This includes Natchantunk, the Anacostan, Piscataway, and Pamunkey peoples. We honor their elders, past and present, as well as future generations. Despite centuries of colonial theft and violence, there is still and always will be Indigenous land. Indigenous people are still here today, demonstrating innumerable talents and gifts in the midst of continued oppression and colonialism. CDP recognizes the injustices that have been done to the Indigenous peoples throughout the United States and elsewhere in the world. The system that became Hurricane Ida was first identified on August 23rd and had reached tropical storm strength by August 26th. After officially becoming Tropical Storm Ida, it continued to rapidly intensify, becoming a Category 1 hurricane on August 27th, shortly before making landfall in Cuba. It passed over Cuba's Isla de Juventud and over the island of Cuba itself without causing major damage, with no reported deaths or injuries in Cuba. Ida continued to move northwest, rapidly intensifying over the warm waters of the Gulf of Mexico. It reached Category 2 strength by noon on August 28th and was a Category 4 storm less than 24 hours later. Ida made landfall as an upper level Category 4 hurricane, only 5 miles per hour short of a Category 5 strength. Key points to know. Ida is tied with the 1856 last hurricane and 2020's Hurricane Laura as the strongest storms to make landfall in Louisiana. Over 1 million customers lost power in Louisiana alone at the height of the storm, including the entire city of New Orleans. As of this morning, there are still more than 900,000 people without power. Many of these locations, including the city of New Orleans, are facing weeks without power as the damage to the transmission infrastructure is significant. New Orleans lost all 8 points of entry into the city for electricity, and even assessing the damage will likely take until the end of this week. Local, state, and federal response teams are already in the area, and there is a lot of immediate support for evacuees. I cannot emphasize one point enough. This disaster is unfolding as we speak. Tornadoes and major flooding swept across the eastern seaboard yesterday, causing extensive damage and fatalities. While today's discussion focuses on Ida's impact in Louisiana, we cannot underestimate the destruction Ida caused in other parts of the country. To update us on relief work in the affected areas and what funders can do to help, we have with us today Jessica Vermilia. She is the Executive Director of the Lutheran Social Services Disaster Response and serves on the board of the Louisiana Volunteer Organizations Active in Disasters. Her organization serves Texas and Louisiana by assisting families and communities in the aftermath of disaster events. Jessica is well versed in the complexities of responding to and recovering from disasters that affect both rural and urban parts of the state. Tanya Gulliver Garcia brings practical, academic, and philanthropic understandings of disasters to her work as CDP's Director of Learning and Partnerships. A self-described disaster junkie who is passionate about ensuring the most marginalized and vulnerable in our communities can recover and build resilience. Her work is grounded in principles of equity and an understanding of how the intersections of race, gender, sexual orientation, age, disability, and class impact the lives of individuals and their families and communities. Join me in welcoming Jessica and Tanya and our thanks to you for taking the time away from your work on this disaster to speak with us today. Jessica, I'm going to start with you. What can you tell us about the pre-disaster landscape of the state of Louisiana and other areas affected by Ida?
Good afternoon, everyone, and thanks to CDP, obviously, for inviting us to talk about this today and for always being a great partner in the work that we all do in recovery. I think the pre-disaster landscape was also a disaster, right? I mean, we're in Louisiana, and as many of you know, and pretty much everyone knows, we are very suspect to continue to receive disasters, and we seem to continuously be in a state of recovery. Our folks, our citizens, our agencies are all very resilient, but that doesn't mean they don't get tired. And so I think what we're seeing is a lot of weariness around having to respond to multiple disasters. As you know, our state was heavily impacted last year in the 2020 season from disasters, not necessarily all in the same location as Ida, but it still has an impact on state's ability to recover, on agencies who are responding. And although we have a very resilient community, we also have great needs, and we can never get ahead of recovery to focus on mitigation. And so those are huge concerns, but definitely a lot of impact. And even though we had pretty much recovered from Katrina in some of these areas, we've also had other disasters along the way, whether it's, Katrina, Rita, Gustav, Ike, Isaac, and the 2016 floods and flooding from last year and other storms and COVID. And so we're really just in a continuous state of recovery.
Thank you. It's so important, that point about fatigue. It really is a critical thing to be watching for. And Tanya, going to you, what can you speak to the needs of small communities in the North Shore and the lower parishes?
Sure. Thanks, Patty. So we hear a lot in the news about the impact on New Orleans, and definitely, as you know, a major city, having everybody be without power and the potential that it's up to a month is definitely, attention worthy. But the lower parishes and places on the North Shore, like St. Tammany and Hammond and Ponchatoula, they got hit even harder than New Orleans. So New Orleans is a power issue with a little bit of tree damage and some power outages, some shingles, that kind of thing. The other places, Lower Plaquemines, the levee broke, Grand Isle, 3 feet of sand over top of it. Hammond, Ponchatoula, trees through roofs on highways. People are not going to get power back there for a few months, quite possibly. And so we need to remember that, French Quarter came on last night, the lights, but that doesn't mean that that's the end of this. It's going to take months of recovery, years of recovery. And we need to support those communities that you've never heard of before and that never, ever make the news cycle.
Tanya, I'm going to stay with you for a second because you spoke about Plaquemines. Can you talk about the repeat trauma that's happening in locations such as that in La Place? I mean, how would you encourage the funder community to attend to these communities that have suffered disaster after disaster?
I think mental health is going to be more important in this disaster than most of the disasters that Jess listed off. And that litany of disasters just flows off when you live and work in New Orleans. I responded in La Place in 2012 during Hurricane Isaac. I responded in La Place to the tornadoes in 2016. I responded in La Place to the floods in 2016. These are communities that are formed by a lot of people who left after Katrina and wanted to move outside of New Orleans. And then they've been hit and hit and hit. And the same is going to be true in New Orleans. People who came from Lake Charles and the surrounding area last year to escape Delta and Laura and have not been able to go back yet. And I just drove through Lake Charles today as I was evacuating. And there's still blue roofs everywhere and buildings that are not constructed, just that you can see from the highway. And now those folks came to this safe zone. And one woman I know with several kids, again, the roof came right off the new apartment she moved into. these folks are going to need years of emergency trauma resilience counseling and long-term recovery work. It's not going to be something that you can just solve with a couple of weeks or a couple of months of crisis counseling.
And that's a great segue, Jessica, for a question for you, because people see the images of devastation on the news and their immediate instinct is to want to help and to help right away. What are some of the ways that folks in Louisiana and around the country can assist in those longer term recovery efforts that Tanya was speaking to?
Well, I first totally agree with everything. Tanya and I think alike, so obviously we typically agree, but yes, first, you know, the emotion that comes over everyone when you see those images and you think back, and I don't know if we mentioned it earlier, but, you know, Ida happened on the 16th anniversary of Katrina. And so if it wasn't already traumatizing enough, that compounded trauma is really heightened because of that. And people around the country and the world also knew that too, because it had been mentioned. And so I think when you see those images, you get these flashbacks and you want to help immediately, and everybody wants to come rushing in and save us, as I say, and we appreciate that and we love it, and we are so very thankful for the desire to want to help, and we understand that initial adrenaline and desire when you see those images that really break your heart and propel you to want to do something. You know, from a faith-based perspective, you know, we're saying pray all you can, because we're collecting prayers so we can pull them out as we need it because we're going to need them for a long, long time. And so those thoughts and prayers we can tuck in our pocket for a while. But the things we would tell people, and our messaging from a Louisiana VOAD perspective, is hold that thought for a minute. We are very heavily impacted. We are right now still dealing with health and safety issues. We don't have power. We don't have water systems. We don't have safe, secure housing for people. You know, we are back to doing congregate sheltering where we are able to do that. We don't have hotel rooms available. And more importantly than some of those, we don't have any gasoline. Gasoline is a huge issue for us. So please don't bring in stuff. We don't have anywhere to put it at the moment, unless you have specifically spoken with someone on the ground and they have said, okay, I have a place for that. I can handle the logistics. Don't, you know, bring in those donations. What we do encourage is donations of cash, because we don't have to worry about the gas to get it to us. And so we also always encourage giving to our partners, our VOAD partners who are trusted in doing this work, and certainly working with CDP to help identify the agencies in that vetting process and the agencies doing good work on the ground. Cash doesn't require us to have extra resources to process it. So that's always a first. We will need stuff. We will need building supplies. We will need all these things that people want to send us, but we're asking people to hold that for a minute until we're able to logistically get settled on the ground. We're working on warehousing. Warehouses were destroyed. Places were destroyed. Logistics are really sketchy. Our emergency management is still working very diligently to make sure people are just safe. Utility workers are everywhere. We don't have housing. We're trying to just get our emergency workers and our healthcare workers stabilized so that they can go to work every day. And so we just ask that you have a little patience with the size of our destruction we have going on this week, and give us a minute. And we're just a few days out from Ida happening. And as you can tell, she's still destroying other parts of the country. She's was a force to be reckoned with, and it will be another mark in our history for sure.
So Jessica, you've spoken a bit about what you're seeing. I'm just wondering if you maybe want to talk a little bit about, you know, what the members are seeing, what they expect to change over the 10 to 30 days. And there's that patience there, but what also might you see changing? And more critically, you know, as a coordinating body, like, what's Louisiana VOAD, how are you responding? What are some of the things that you're looking at doing right now?
Sure. So Louisiana VOAD did call together and met with our membership prior to the storm, pre-landfall, just as a check-in to make sure that, you know, we were all okay and let people know how to connect with us. And we've been holding, since this past Monday, landfall, we've been holding daily call-ins. And so we have daily call-ins going now. We'll probably shift that after next week. But those calls are just primarily for us to allow we want to lift up our local VOADs. I mean, the state VOAD isn't, we are not able to do this work. We are the people on the ground at our community level, at our local VOADs who are doing that work on the ground, we want to lift them up, and we're here to support them. So we then can ask for what they need and help get that into them. And so we really want to lift them up. So we're providing space on our call each day for them to be able to check in, identify urgent needs that we are doing. We're asking our partners to send in online reports for the planned activities that they have so we can be aware of that. We are asking folks to, you know, not self-deploy. We've got big issues with that. We're asking folks to definitely affiliate. We are utilizing our wonderful partners at Volunteer Louisiana for unaffiliated folks, and for our agencies also to post the things that they are, if they're coordinating and they're going to be asking for volunteers, they can register there. Also for donations, if they have a fund that's set up that can be donated to, we would like them to register through that. So we're trying to have shared messaging across the state, across FEMA, and across VOAD. So we'll continue to have our meetings. Right now, we are still in definitely in response, early response. But as we all know, recovery starts day one as well. And so we know that that recovery will look different as we move down the road. Right now, obviously, those immediate, early response things, tarps and water and those kind of supplies that we're needing. And then as we move on, we'll certainly be needing those rebuilding materials. This is going to be a really long battle that we're fighting. And so we do have the Operation Blue Roof that started yesterday through the Corps of Engineers. And so some of the 13 parishes were allowed for that. So we'll be getting some assistance with that. But housing is going to be an issue. And so we're asking our agencies just to make sure they're coordinating with us and connecting to the local VOAD so that we can better coordinate across all systems and have better communication and coordination in that way.
And that's so great. I mean, Jessica, I just want to underline a couple of points you made there to make sure it's captured by our audience. Local, get as local as you can. Recognize the importance of coordination. It's really critical to balance not only the response, but understanding the needs and collaboration. And I just think those are really fabulous points, and I wanted to underline them. Tanya, your state is in Louisiana is your home. It's in the heart of the disaster. What would you recommend funders do right now to address the needs that they're seeing?
Well, obviously, as Jess mentioned, we do think a lot alike and have similar messaging. I remember one disaster where Jessica literally cut all her food in half, so I had something to eat. I think it's similar to what she's suggesting for VOAD partners and those that want to support them. Remember that this is going to be long term. Remember that. I spent 5.5 hours yesterday in a line to get gas, and the generator that runs the pumps ran out of gas. And then the warehouse that holds the gasoline to fuel the generator ran out of gas in that generator. So there is a lot of chaos right now. Even as you see lights come on, don't think that this situation is over. Things like ice, in this picture I took at this little closed drugstore where I know somebody broke in, the lock's broken off on here, just to see if there was any hope of getting some ice, even though it would have been melted. They're desperate situations. So for funders, if you're going to fund, especially in the recovery stage, I would love for you to start coordinating and working with other funders. And in New Orleans and in the greater New Orleans area, there are lots of funders who have a history of doing this kind of work, especially through the Greater New Orleans Funders Network. That kind of work can be extended to the surrounding other 12 parishes. Look at getting joint forms so that an organization does not need to apply to every single funder that's going to be responded. You can communicate and coordinate and only have one application form, one evaluation form. The optics of giving now obviously are more attractive perhaps to donors or to corporate customers and that kind of thing. So give now. The VOAD groups that are on the ground now are going to need that support, and those that are local are going to be here for a long time and they'll continue to do that recovery work. But also set aside some money. As Jess said, we are looking at years of recovery work. Just for my drive in out of New Orleans today, you know, there's lots of helpers coming in. They all need places to stay. They all need support. There's literally nothing in the city right now to maintain any kind of infrastructure. So support those organizations that can be self-contained, that have a place to stay, are bringing in their own kitchen, are bringing in their own shower tents, are bringing in their own bathrooms. Things that you might not always think of funding will be really important for those organizations on the ground because of the power outage. And in some communities like Kenner, which is where the airport is, just outside of New Orleans proper, where there's no water at all, you're going to need potable water brought in as well.
So Tanya, I'm going to stick with you for a moment. So you've talked about, you know, what they need to keep in mind and for that recovery, but what about an equitable recovery? What are some of the long-term implications that they need to keep in mind to support equitable recovery?
As with most disasters, this hurricane is going to affect those people that have been most at risk. And in a city like New Orleans, and even in the broader state, we have extremely high rates of poverty, low rates of education, high infant mortality and low birth weight babies. There's a community in New Orleans that dies 25 years earlier than there's a Black community. Let me be very specific. There's a Black community in New Orleans that dies 25 years earlier than the white community just a few miles away. And that's because of lack of access to health services and community supports. The funders really need to think about all of those issues. And when we get more rural, when we move out to the lower parishes, these are completely subsistence communities. A friend of mine lost two boats. She's still recovering from the BP oil spill in 2010. I don't think that was on Jessica's list, but there's another disaster that people are trying to still recover from. And this is costing tons of money that people don't have. And that's a big reason people didn't evacuate. So you really need to think about who is most harmed by this disaster, whether that's based on race or gender or age or sexual orientation or location, going back to those rural communities and the repeat ones. How can you really fund and support people so that recovery actually means something? And when we're layering COVID on top, it's only 2 weeks out that Louisiana was number one in the world for new COVID cases. We have no idea where we stand right now because they can't collect numbers and there's no testing happening in the state. We don't know what's happened over the last couple of weeks. But with congregate sheltering and people evacuating to live with in-laws and family and friends, we know there's going to be intense community spread. And we lost all our festivals this year because of COVID. And folks said they would still come and support the tourism industry in New Orleans and the culture bearers that live and work here. But now they might not be able to because the hotels are going to be needed for evacuees or people who still can't get back home. And the city might not be up and running in time for folks to honor those obligations to come.
No, that really sobering reflections there. And I hope everyone really takes them to heart in terms of how we look at it. And I think my next question for you, Jess, is about this as well, which is, you know, this area is also hit by hurricanes last year. We've talked about these chronic crises that keep hitting these communities. You know, how do you think they will recover after repeat disasters? You know, what might need to change?
I think, and we did talk about it, I mentioned it earlier, we're always in recovery. We can never get to mitigation and we can never get to how to do it better. And somebody somewhere, somehow at some level needs to start what that conversation looks like. Will it be painful? Likely. Uncomfortable? Definitely. But we have to start talking about how we can do things differently. And one of the things that I've had concerns about is, you know, from a traditional response, we go in, we fix it, we leave, you know, we go in, we fix stuff. We do that. We try to be cognizant of the money we're spending, but how do we encourage doing things better, more resilient from a building aspect, if that means raising? I understand that might be helping less people because the money's more, but where do we make that decision? How do we start making those tough decisions? And part of that is going to be listening to communities. And we've got to, you know, local response belongs to the local community, and we have to start talking about listening to those communities and what they're feeling and the impact. We definitely have issues around economics, as Tanya was mentioning. We definitely have issues around that. Going back to the BP oil disaster, you know, people have been displaced from that, between that and COVID and the hit to the tourism industry. Economically, the state is going to see a hit. We always lift up because, you know, it's New Orleans and that's what makes the news, but it is these rural areas that there is a lot of concern. Our farming communities, our crawfish, our fishermen, our oystermen, our shrimpers. We have a rich history of that subsistence farming and lifestyle, and we're losing that. And between climate change and the disasters and the impacts, these are just really difficult questions. And so how do we recover better while still being equitable? I was happy to see FEMA has pushed out some new policies around equitable recovery. And that's great. We've been advocating for those changes. It takes a long time, but we have to do something to make a difference in how we recover. I'm highly concerned with the mental health and behavioral health issues that we already know are there. These compounded disasters, especially with COVID, we're seeing people are blowing up in gas lines. There's a lot of anger. Deputies are not able to deal with other things because they're being dispatched to go out and deal with fights in gas lines and at stores. People are on the edge. And so we really have to be able to address those concerns. We certainly have, the coverage area for this is just huge, right? I mean, it goes all the way from Grand Isle, which now has 3 to 4 feet of sand on it and is inaccessible, to Lafourche and Terrebonne in New Orleans and St. John. Oh my, you know, my heart breaks because when I see this stuff, these are places that we've done recovery work before and we know these people. Those relationships that we've built over the years in this work, we know our heart breaks for them because they're going through it again. And I can't tell you how many conversations I've had and late night back and forth emails with people that has turned into a mental health conversation around, I feel like I'm going through Katrina again.
So Jess, let's stick with you for a second. I mean, mental health is obviously something that's there. Economics is something that's there. What else would you guide in terms of what can philanthropy do to help and support these communities, these smaller rural communities?
Well, I think lifting up, we need to do probably more community organizing than we have. We have some great community-based organizations that are on the ground. We need to learn to bring them together. How can we bring them together for these bigger conversations and how to do this work, how we can bring the community together? We're definitely going to need rebuilding. I mean, that's going to be a huge issue for a very, very long time. It's not a, you know, as we always say, don't spend all your money up front. You're going to need it 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 years down the road when the media spotlight isn't sitting on this. But, you know, I always say if we can rebuild somebody's house, but if they're not okay, we've got to make sure the people are okay. And there's a lot of work to be done there. So looking at how we get people back into jobs, how we deal with the lack of childcare, how we deal with poverty, how we deal with food insecurity. You could basically pick any area that you want to support that, you know, is a wrench in your heart and do something with that because the need is just incredibly great.
It's very, very powerful statement. I hope everyone takes that to heart. And Tanya, you know, Louisiana is going to be in a recovery mode for a long time. You and Jessica have both kind of made that pretty clear. It's been there for a while already. What would you like funders to be thinking about 3 years from now? And if you could, the same as Jessica, maybe talk a little bit about it, whether you see any differences at a rural versus an urban level in how that recovery might be looking.
Sure. I would love, Patty, for funders in 3 years to be thinking about renewing a lease on an office or employing staff that are still dedicated to Louisiana for the next few years after that. I want funders now to think about this as a long-term project. And we have funders that have been with us since Katrina in 2012 or in 2005. Isaac was actually August 29th. That was 2012, the oil spill, you know, and those funders have stuck with it. But there are other disasters happening all around the world, and especially in the U.S., and even just with Ida across the U.S. itself. So I want funders to think about, you know, how can they decide now that they're going to be here in 3 years, in 5 years, in 10 years? And what can they do to position themselves as a cooperative partner to the organizations on the ground that are going to deal with those most vulnerable populations? I went on my evacuation today. I noticed that a lot of the severe damage in Kenner is in Hispanic community. And some of those folks will not be documented, or one person in the family will not be. And so making sure that services are provided equitably to everybody, regardless of status and paperwork. A lot of the people who evacuated last year still don't have their ID back. So thinking about ways that we can support those communities specifically. And then, you know, these small communities that have been hit so much, you know, and just thinking of the North Shore, Tangipahoa, Hammond, St. Tammany as a whole, you know, those are places, as Jessica says, that the warehouses normally are, and that we evacuate to. Lots of the point-to-point, parish-to-parish shelters were set up in those areas, and now they've been devastated. You know, how are we going to get those folks home? Because there's not rental properties available. They're not easily accessible. There's not tons of hotels. There's not extra space. So are we looking at trailers, RVs, mobile homes? Are we looking at a long-term situation of people being displaced? And, you know, I tried to look at a hotel last night, and the closest I could find was an hour over the border in Texas. There's just nothing, because so many of us are evacuating and evacuated either before the storm or in these past 5 days. So how are you going to do that work long-term? How are you going to find the organizations where maybe there's only two organizations right now that actually exist and work in a community, or they're super local and they don't have the normal structures you would look at as a big funder? How are you going to support those organizations, the mutual aid organizations, the pop-up food programs that have started since this storm even, or since COVID, or remain in the legacy of Katrina, Isaac, Gustav, Ike, all the others?
Tanya, I'm going to do the facilitator's prerogative. I'm going to pull a question from the Q&A, because you raised the evacuation. You talked about, you know, the people moving and the ability to return home or not. And there's a question for us about how to support those who left Louisiana and have moved temporarily to other cities like in Texas or other places. What would be some advice you would give for philanthropy about that?
Well, I think, Patty, that's a super challenging issue. You know, one of the things we saw with Hurricane Maria was that a lot of people moved off the island of Puerto Rico and came to Orlando. There was a huge community that moved to Philadelphia, and the supports are not set up in those communities. You know, the food service organizations are going to Puerto Rico. They're not going to Philly. And so funders need to look at, where did folks evacuate to? Right now, and this will change, it's anywhere really west of Lafayette, through to Houston, Austin, Dallas. A lot of people went east, even though the storm was going east. So all of the Florida panhandle, parts of Mississippi, or that landmass between Louisiana and Alabama, as we like to call it, lots of folks in Alabama, folks in Atlanta. So if you're a funder in those communities, reach out to some of the hotels and find out if folks are staying in your community. You know, there's a mattress store in Houston that is feeding and sheltering hundreds and hundreds of evacuees, and they do this every time there's a big event in Houston. But the services are going to need to happen here as well as in Louisiana. We're going to need to have services all over to be able to support these communities, especially those folks who can't get back right away. You know, we have no idea when our power is going on. Some came on yesterday. Unfortunately for me, it came on at the other end of my block, which is only, or my street, which is only five blocks long. And I could hear the people shouting and cheering and letting off fireworks, and I could even see their lights as I sweated in the 105 degree heat. But we need that support to happen on an ongoing basis as people struggle with, can they even go back? What happened to their home? Is it better for them to establish roots in the new community and just start over somewhere far away from disasters if this is the third or fourth hurricane they've gone through in the last 12 months? And for many of us, it is.
Yeah, that's a great point in terms of those concurrent disasters. So Jessica, I'd like you to talk a little bit about how the pandemic is affecting response and recovery efforts.
Sure. Before I move to that, can I just comment briefly on what we were just discussing? So I had the opportunity yesterday to participate for a short amount of time while I had the opportunity in Alabama's VOAD call and kind of give them a high level update. And, you know, that's there. We have our people there. And so the first thing I did was thank Alabama VOAD and their state for hosting our people, but also trying to make sure we're sharing that messaging. We had, you know, the same issue last year with Laura with our folks in Texas because they're close to the border. So, you know, I'd get on the Texas VOAD calls and kind of brief that. I think that communication piece, you know, hopefully the state level is communicating how many people, sort of, we think we got this many people. But from a VOAD level, there's also some importance in creating that cross-state ability and mutual aid to support and making sure they have good information to provide your people so that they can do that outreach and they can make sure, because the message out, you know, don't come back. There's no gas, there's no power, there's no food, you know, don't come back right now. It's a problem. It's problematic, how to register for FEMA, you know, how to do all that. So yes, there's definitely a piece there that we need to coordinate better on as communities and states. COVID, well, COVID has done a number on us and continues to, and as we all know, Louisiana has not done a really great job of, although we've tried, folks getting vaccinated, and for a number of reasons. I mean, fear, a number of reasons. And we know that this fourth surge that we've been going into, that we absolutely, as Tanya mentioned earlier, have no idea where we're at currently, is a little scary, honestly. I think, you know, certainly in this environment of post-disaster, the last thing I'm going to think about while I'm trying to manage my recovery is I need to put on a mask when I'm in public. And so, and people hug each other to comfort, because as humans and our human, natural human, we want to give you a hug. We want to love on you because you're hurting. And that's how we do that. But we're hugging you probably without a mask on. So there is opportunity now more than ever for that spread. We know that the Lake Charles area post Laura was one of the most highly impacted areas in vaccination rates. And, you know, COVID was spreading there. People are traumatized. Getting a COVID shot and protecting themselves is just, they're already traumatized. It's just not something they can process or deal with. And so COVID has really impacted us, not only from that area, but from economic standpoint, certainly, and also from just from a voluntary agency standpoint, it has highly impacted our ability to normally, and as we would traditionally utilize volunteers to do this work. We have to spread out volunteer housing. Volunteers aren't able to travel like they could. As you know, some of our best volunteers are our more mature folks who now have to be concerned about COVID. And, you know, we all know that even though we get COVID vaccinations, that we still can get COVID. So there's a lot of concerns. It really has hampered their ability to recover at the rate that we normally would, even though that's slow. And so slow has gotten slower. And honestly, the compounded trauma, again, from the pandemic has certainly led to some real issues. It also has caused some issues around raising funds for specific natural disasters because so many people are also giving to COVID, not that they shouldn't, but it's just watering down that pool, as you all well know.
Well, actually, Jess, I'm going to come to Tanya on this question. Before I do so, that is actually a question that was in the from the audience related to the fatigue, donor fatigue, as it's called. You know, serious damages, so many other challenges happening. What would you advise? How do we combat that? And then I'll come to you, Tanya, to address the same and also talk about COVID.
I was hoping you had the magic answer for that. Right? I'm not sure. Everybody's fatigued, not only donor fatigue, but response fatigue. I mean, we see people in just the disaster space fatigued and leaving because they just can't face it again. So, you know, when you put dollars towards something, you want to see that that's going towards something that hopefully is making a positive difference for the future. How do we do that when we're seeing homes that we've put money into before re-impacted again and again, and making sure that our funds are going towards something that's more sustainable? Again, it kind of goes back to those hard conversations about how we fund stuff and what we fund. I think some of this, the ability to have some more cooperative shared funding opportunities, to have those conversations between different types of funders is helpful. I don't have a magic answer, unfortunately. I think we just have to show that we want to do things correctly. We have to certainly continue to build trust that what we're doing in recovery and where your money's going is making a difference for the future.
And Tanya, on to you on COVID, but if you can also talk about donor fatigue. And I have shared the blog that you wrote, if you can believe it, a little bit over a week ago on COVID.
I can't believe that was a week ago. So COVID, definitely a huge challenge. The folks that were running a lot of the vaccinations and the testing sites in New Orleans are National Guard. Those National Guard have been pulled off to run the pods, the points of distribution. I went yesterday to get ice and went through the same place that I went through to get my COVID test. Same people, in fact, in some cases. And so there's just a system that we would normally deal with for managing COVID. But as I said earlier, you know, the level of poverty that's pre-existing in New Orleans and in especially rural and smaller communities, Lafourche, Terrebonne, Plaquemines, Lower Jefferson, especially Lower St. Bernard, TNG, St. Tammany, and Baton Rouge. I think we really can't forget Baton Rouge. You know, I was mile 65 from my house and there was still no power. I'm in the capital city and I think I'm in 150 miles before I hit power today. This is a huge swath of the state. And so we're talking about places, you know, Baton Rouge and New Orleans have 60-70% vaccination rate. These smaller communities, some of them have 30 or 40% vaccination rate, you know, and a lot of that is about access and the ability of people on a normal good day to go get a shot and to have that time if they need 3 or 4 days off work. If you're a shrimper or an oysterman, a fisherman, you know, those products don't stop just because you need to take 3 days off. If you don't show up for the work, you know, your captain is not going to hire you again. And so you can't lose that time that, you know, some of us who have a different kind of job, an office job, can take that time off. And then, Patty, I think that leads into the fatigue question, too, because we're all tired. Right? Like the blog I wrote that you reference is, you know, about being in the center and you know, living at the center of COVID, I thought was bad enough. And having gone through Zeta last year, this was my 21st disaster for CDP in 21. I had 20 in 2020, I had 21 in 21. We see from last year with Laura and Delta and Zeta that the money isn't there. We see that from the winter storms. We see that even with the wildfires happening right now. And so funders, as much as possibly, especially corporate funders or private foundations, family foundations, and I've said this on every webinar I've done in the last year and a half, need to dig deep, right? This is the rainy day. This is the time to spend your money. And a lot of that can also on a local level be done through mutual aid. You don't have to give money if you're an individual who's also hurting, but you might be able to give some kind of support, you know, childcare to just help out someone who's trying to do things like spend 5.5 hours in a line to get gas. Those things are very challenging. The picture we were looking at before this one is a mom living, she had three kids in that house when three trees went through the roof. It took her ex-husband 10, 12 hours to get to her in the middle of the hurricane to evacuate them. You know, she had a little tiny Fiat, and that is not going over the three pine trees in the pole that are down across her driveway. And so everyone is gonna need that support from everyone. And so we just have to figure out what can each of us do, whether we have $5 or whether we have $5 billion.
And that's a great point. There's actually been a few questions here related to, you know, where do we direct individuals to you know, people who want to help? How do they get information on what the needs are? How do they know where to channel their efforts, you know, and where to give donations or even to give cash? What might be some of the advices you would give for those who are looking at how to help, maybe further away? What would be the advice you would have for where to, how to find info, how to direct their resources?
CDP has what we call a disaster profile, and it's on our website under disasters drop down. And we have one for all of the Atlantic hurricanes that have happened so far, but Ida obviously being at the top and being a focus. It explains what's happening, what the updates are. As the impacts of the Northeast come in over this weekend, that will get built into it as well. And then it has recommendations for how you can help, what can you do, the kinds of groups and organizations you should be funding and supporting. At CDP, we have an Atlantic Hurricane Fund. We maintain a list of NGOs like VOAD organizations that Jessica is a part of with Louisiana VOAD, or more local, smaller nonprofits and organizations based in Louisiana that are going to be here for the next 10 years, as well as those community funds. So, you know, these are small communities, but they often still have community foundations or a local United Way, and those are often a good place. I'm happy, especially now that I have power, to provide recommendations to funders who are trying to look for advice. You know, see if they're a VOAD organization, see what their reputation is in the community, make sure they have worked in the community before and they're familiar with it. A lot of the national NGOs that are coming in over the last 5 days have been here through COVID or have been here through one of our other 10 or 20 disasters in the last 16 years. And so they know the communities really well, and they know how to provide that support of the state, because each of the 13 parishes and more that are impacted have a really different culture. Lafayette is not New Orleans, is not Slidell, mm-hmm. is not Grand Isle.
Jessica, do you want to come in on that as well?
Yeah, I think, you know, it is truly, there's so many ways that you can certainly connect We want people to connect into those local groups that are actively doing things on the ground that are part of their community. And, you know, certainly the recommendations Tanya had with connecting to CDP and the information that you guys provide, there are local foundations. And I can tell you that our local foundations come to us and verify, they're like, who's doing the work, right? So we are in communication about that. And so we appreciate the fact that we have foundations and groups that put out early funding to get some, you know, real quick assistance on the ground, but they also understand the need to continue raising those funds for the long term. And so those organizations who have a process for kind of managing that in a smart way are great. Like I said, we are certainly promoting Volunteer Louisiana to list some of our local foundations and funds that are being put up, but give as close locally as you can in those situations, and certainly utilize CDP as a resource to understand how to vet that and opportunities. There are a lot of things we can do. We have so many things that unfortunately we don't have the capacity to fund. That would be great if we could do wonderful things, and we all have great ideas in our head about how that could be, but we're usually busy putting out fires to be able to plan those things. And so being able to come together at a higher level like this to have these discussions is super helpful.
That's great. Jess, I'm going to stick with you for a minute, because as you know, we have a lot of FEMA that normally calls into this webinar, and we have a great opportunity here to just talk about, you know, in your, from your point of view, what has FEMA learned over the past decade, but what gaps still exist in the immediate aftermath of a disaster that you'd like them to learn and work on?
Wow. And you still want them to be my friends. I love FEMA. And so none of the ones that know me would have, they would know, cause I've already told them. So we love FEMA and we love what they do, but you know, it's a bureaucratic process that takes time to change. And like I said, I was so excited last night to be able to send out their new policy guidelines around some of the equity issues we have, even in being able to apply to FEMA, right? The process itself is just burdensome. And, you know, I realize they have things they have to do, but they are working with us to help move some of those things forward. So I would say the things that have been gone really well and continue to go well is that they're listening. They hear what we're saying. And so that communication to hear what we're saying, what the needs are, it's the process of getting those changes to happen. They just also implemented some funding that comes now automatically for certain mitigation items. And that program is to grow over time. And so there are things that are happening. It's just the length of time it takes for that action to happen once the problem is identified. Certainly COVID has had an impact on that, and I didn't really talk about it, but the ability, FEMA is usually in the community and those open centers, DRC centers, disaster recovery centers, let me acronym myself properly, in the disaster recovery centers to be able to be there face-to-face to help people sign up. With COVID, we didn't have that ability. People were always having to call in. I mean, we have to remember this morning we have in Louisiana for Ida already over 200,000 registrations. But you've got to remember, we still have people without power or electricity or cell phones that work. They're trying to call in, but they wait on the line. And about the time they get connected, you're next up on the phone line and their power gives out or they lose their connection. And so the frustration from not being able to do that face-to-face is very frustrating. The ability for us not to be able to do case management face-to-face sometimes is frustrating. To have communities, and FEMA has done a good job of this as well. They also listen to this and doing it, to be able to do more trainings about registration for FEMA so that our people in our communities can help folks get registered and help them understand about appeals and help them understand what documents they need, have the ability to go in somewhere and upload those documents when FEMA's not able to be there in person. So I think the communication has certainly increased and gotten better. If they can figure out a way to cut red tape and get bureaucracy out the way for a while, that would be fabulous. But continuing to listen to the needs and move it forward as quickly as possible, the number of layers for that to get processed is troublesome and burdensome. I would say overall, they're doing a great job, but there certainly is always room for improvement in those processes.
Well, that's the thing with disasters. We can always improve, all of us. So it's always great to get some of that advice to know where to target our energies. Tanya, You mentioned that donors could use a common application form to fund more locally. Do you have a source? Do you have a recommendation you would make for those who are looking to access this?
Make three recommendations, Patty. The first is that Wendy Burton, one of our partners at the Communities Foundation of Texas, for COVID, I guess, and has a fair number of donors that are all working together, has a great model, a great example that I'm sure she wouldn't mind if folks reached out to her. We're looking at incorporating stuff like that into our disaster philanthropy playbook. So people could also look to that in the very, very near future. And then the other one is you can actually Google Louisiana Common Application Philanthropy, and an example comes up that was supported by several foundations, I believe around Katrina, but the application form itself is still there. And I think, you know, because we want to talk about long-term recovery, you have some time. CDP doesn't generally make recovery grants for 6 to 12 months because we know that it needs to be long-term. So talk to Wendy, take that application, get some funders together and hammer something out that you think could be very collaborative, shorter than the one that's online, no logic models. And, you know, CDP staff are always helpful, are always willing to provide advice and help with that as well.
That's great. And I think that's all the time we have for questions today. I know I'm leaving a few up in the Q&A. There seem a lot that just came in the last couple of minutes. So we will try and address them as best we can, you know, in other takeaways that we do. But just a few takeaways from this call that I want people to leave with. One, you know, if you can take the long view, as you heard from Jessica, still feeling the impact from 2020 disasters, Louisiana, you know, across the U.S., there's a continuing state of recovery that's in place, but Louisiana has been especially hit over the past year. Thoughts and prayers need to be thought, you know, tuck them into your pockets. Louisiana is going to need help for years to come. And really remember, it's a long-term. As Tanya reminded us, you know, same thing, long-term, and this is beyond New Orleans. You remember to think also of the rural areas. This experienced trauma is something that is gonna just build up. It will take years, not just a few weeks or months of counseling to kind of purge from people's systems to work towards that greater recovery, both of their community, but of themselves. So ask yourselves as funders, you know, what can you do to stay 3 years, 5 years? How do you support local organizations to have that longevity? Really important in terms of take the long view. The next takeaway, recognize there are places private philanthropy can help that government agencies might not. Jessica spoke about the great work FEMA is doing, but that's not all that is needed. Get as local as you can, look at collaborating. This is the rainy day, you know, time to dig deep and bring that funding forward. All funders are disaster funders. You know, it is so interconnected. Jessica talked about this, Tanya spoke about this. You cannot separate the root causes, the situation of where the hurricane arrived, what happened, what was there before the hurricane. It will definitely impact that longer term. It connects with many other issues. So if you care about food insecurity or mental health or education, and you're looking at helping, remember, this is, you know, that's a disaster philanthropy. Look at that longer term. Look at how you can help that community recover. Share best practices and learn lessons from past disasters. This is not the first time this has happened. We don't need to invent it. Have patience as things are unfolding. But, you know, there's a desire to respond right away, but organizations do have some limitations. Find out what's needed. Go through those local VOADs. Remember, it's cash, not stuff. That can really create a complexity for the responders on the ground. It can get in the way of the very thing you're trying to do. That's a huge lesson learned from past disasters. And support community engagement and advocacy. Make it as local as possible. Listen to communities. Again, really great lessons learned from past crises that have been shared by Jessica and Tanya today. And of course, really collaborate and coordinate as best you can outside of the disaster. If you're a funder, learn what others are doing, see how you can amplify and connect and match what they're doing so that funding goes further, goes longer. And lastly, trust the experts. We have a lot of resources, but as Jessica said, the local response belongs to the local community. Listen to them, especially hard-hit subsistence economic communities for equitable recovery. The VOADs are a great resource. CDP uses them quite a lot. So, you know, they're there and definitely worth looking at. Additionally, CDP has many resources devoted to that, the disaster philanthropy that can assist you. The Issues Insight provides an introductory look at disasters and responses. There are recordings of past webinars you can view. There are a few people that highlighted about wanting to learn more about past disasters or current disasters. We always have these webinars to get deeper into issues. The profiles provide regular information about the impact of a disaster and the needs of the community to inform philanthropy of how they can help. Tanya referred to that. There's a monthly newsletter full of information. CDP staff are always available to provide guidance. And if you need more information, more in-depth assistance, we can also provide a variety of consulting services. You can learn more about our work at disasterphilanthropy.org. The Center for Disaster Philanthropy's Atlantic Hurricane Season Recovery Fund is devoted to supporting medium and long-term recovery needs stemming from Hurricane Ida. We know from previous experience, the focus of most individual giving is that immediate relief phase, but as our panelists have shared, there will be long ongoing needs to assist with recovery for many years to come. Please join CDP on September 9th at 2 p.m. Eastern for our next webinar, COVID-19's Long Tail, Developing a Mental Health Strategy for Recovery. Both our panelists spoke about the importance of mental health recovery, and here's a webinar that will help you think that through. In order to respect everyone's time and keep this to the hour, unfortunately, that's all we have for today. Thank you, Jessica and Tanya, for taking time to share your thoughts with us. Special thanks to our co-sponsors, Charity Navigator, Council on Foundations, the Funders Network, Giving Compass, the National Center on Family Philanthropy, National Voluntary Organizations Active in Disasters, Philanthropy New York, the Southeastern Council on Foundations, United Philanthropy Forum. If you have any questions or thoughts on things that were not addressed today, please email Regine at regine.webster@disasterphilanthropy.org. Thank you and have a great afternoon.